Kultur.
Das Kulturmagazin auf Mordica
FM.
Kultur.
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 Einen schönen guten Tag und willkommen zu einer weiteren Ausgabe von Kultur oder Kontrapunkt, das ist nicht ganz sicher. Wir nehmen einfach mal Kultur. Es könnte auch eine Kontroverse werden. Das werden wir im Laufe der Sendung sehen. Am Mikrofon begrüßt Sie bzw. euch Eike Gebhardt für Radio Multikult FM aus der Heinicke-Markthalle in Kreuzberg. Das Thema der Women's Peace March in Berlin. Der Freitag, den 16. am Alexanderplatz und Brandenburger Tor stattfinden wird. Die Details werden wir am Schluss noch einmal ansagen. Auf Initiative der preisgekrönten Singer-Songwriterin und Friedensaktivistin Yael Deckelbaum und ihrer Bewegung Women Wage Peace marschierten Ende letzten Jahres 30.000 Frauen unterschiedlichster Religionen und Herkunft aus dem Norden Israels nach Jerusalem. Mit der Forderung nach Frieden legten Tausende von Menschen den Weg singend zurück und machten mit der Hymne Prayer of the Mothers den Marsch zum weltweiten Symbol für Versöhnung und Menschlichkeit. Zeitgleich haben sich zahlreiche Women's Marches überall auf der Welt formiert, zum Beispiel in New York, London, Stockholm, Jerusalem, Sydney, Zürich und eben jetzt auch in Berlin. Die Veranstaltungsreihe Puls des Friedens wurde durch den Verein Clans des Friedens e.V. ins Leben gerufen. Sie verstehen sich als Teil dieser globalen Bewegung und organisieren den Women's Peace March in Berlin, wie gesagt, am 16. um 17 Uhr. Die Details sagen wir nachher nochmal an. Am 16. will also um 17 Uhr der March vom Alexanderplatz, vom Neptunbrunnen singend zum Brandenburger Tor ziehen. Warum singend? Das werden wir nachher noch diskutieren. Das ist offensichtlich ein Teil des Programms, dass Singen als eine Art Droge, als ein Rausch begriffen wird, der die Menschen zusammenbringt. Die Kundgebung wird von weiteren internationalen Gästen begleitet, unter anderem von den Gewinnern des Karnevals der Kulturen 2017, Lakalake. Sie unterstützen den Auftritt mit ihrer Performance, ebenso wie Moetu Taiha, eine Maori-Älteste, oder Bernd Kolb, der gerade seine Brahman-Ausstellung in der Malzfabrik eröffnet hat. Gemeinsam möchten sie alle auch hier in Berlin ein Zeichen für den globalen menschlichen Schulterschluss setzen. Was für eine schöne Metapher. Frauen und Mütter stehen weltweit auf für ein friedliches Gleichgewicht auf unserer Erde. Frieden, heißt es, ist eine Sinfonie, die sich aus den unterschiedlichsten Klängen von Gemeinschaft, Freiheit, Menschenrechten, Kreativität, Bildung und Gleichgewicht zusammensetzt. So das Manifest. Ich darf nun die Gäste begrüßen. Yael Deckelbaum, die Singer-Songwriterin-Legende persönlich. Sie können viele Videos auf YouTube oder im Netz ganz generell abrufen. Miriam Tukan, sie ist Palästinenserin, Araberin, lebt allerdings in Israel am Galiläischen Meer. Die beiden treten oft zusammen auf, vor allem im Kontext des Women's March for Peace und des berühmten Songs Mother's Prayers for Peace. Yael Deckelbaum ist eine Kanadierin, Israelin, und Miriam Tukan kommt aus Palästina. Dazu die Organisatoren des ganzen Events ist Pulse for Freedom, Pulse of Freedom oder Puls des Friedens, Anja Kaul, und die Initiatoren des Clans des Friedens, Margret Hoffmann. Am Mikrofon noch einmal Eike Gebhardt. So, meine lieben Zuhörer, Zuhörerinnen, das muss man ja heute getrennt alles sagen, da einige von unseren Gästen kein Deutsch sprechen, was verzeihlich ist, werden wir diese Sendung, wie schon so oft zuvor, auf Englisch führen. Das heißt, die Diskussion, Sie können natürlich gerne später sich melden. Wir werden Ihnen gerne eine deutsche Zusammenfassung liefern. Und es ist natürlich nachzuhören auf unserer Website. Nichtsdestoweniger, die Diskussion jetzt mit den Gästen findet statt auf Englisch. All right, let's start with the initiators of the whole movement. Why women? We men feel terribly discriminated. Why did you select only women for the peace march? Do you think women are predestined for peace? Margaret Mitscherlich, a famous psychoanalyst in Germany, wrote Friedfertige Frau, as if there was a natural affinity of women to peace and for men to being belligerent. To the initiators, why Women's Peace March? I mean, we as men typically feel discriminated. I mean, you women have had that for thousands of years, obviously, that you were discriminated against. Why are women, in your eyes, predestined for peace as opposed to men? Why Women's Peace March? Is it a strategic question that you think it's more persuasive, a women march, women singing, after all, quite an event? Or is there a kind of tacit principle why you only select women for that kind of march, for that kind of program?
Well, for a start, it's not that we only select women, because men are very welcome and needed to join. But it's more that I think we women came to a point where we have enough of the old structure, and so we gather our sisters and we march together. And I think we women, well, especially the mothers, they have the ability to really give life, to materialize life, and it's very hard to see your child die or to see the child of your sister or neighbor die. And I think also we women suffer the most, women and children, of all the war going on. And so, of course, for me it makes perfect sense that the women come together, unify and say, okay, no, we live a different life right now and we live a peaceful life right now. But like I said, we women may lead or initiate this new peace movement, but you're welcome to join. Every man is welcome to join, of course.
Now, of course, as you probably know, there are many women that will contradict you. For instance, a famous feminist, German feminist, Barbara Sichtermann, said, hey, women were always behind the men, you know, with their adoration of belligerence, of heroic men, of strong, competitive men, right? All that, these are the kind of men, and every man knows painfully, you know, when he's in a competition at a party or whatever, you know, and there is one of these heroic figures, the women will fly in that direction, just like men will direct their views first, you know, to women that are more attractive. It's just one of these things. So is it possible that
times are changing?
Yes.
Just to say that.
Fortunately, but...
This is how it used to be, and I'm not saying that it's wrong it's just times are changing. There's a shift. This is how the world used to be in the patriarchal times. And
you mean in the present?
The present is the shift. The past is patriarchal. The future is balance. And we have not balanced yet. And it needs to be balanced. It's not about, everybody is a part of how the system used to work. Everybody has a responsibility. The women have a responsibility for playing along with the old system. The men have a responsibility for leading the old system. The women also have a responsibility for letting it be as it was. And it's not about blaming the past. It's about changing it into something better and growing.
That's exactly what we want to know. Obviously, how do you go about changing it? I mean, one thing is changing the circumstances, for instance, new laws, you know, that give more rights to women. After all, you know, like 50 years ago, women couldn't have, in Germany and many other countries, a bank account of their own. They couldn't take a job, you know, without the permission, the husbands, you know, and so on and so on. All these things have changed. This is changing the circumstances and the conditions of living. That's one thing. The other is changing the frame of mind, both of the women and the men.
Yes.
How do you go about that?
It's a deep work.
Yes.
It's very deep.
A long process.
And that we are painfully aware of. But how do you go about it strategically?
We go by it intuitively, first of all. It strategically is also a different way. There is
a male word you want to tell
me. It's not a male word. It's just not relevant to this new movement, which is it's global. It's happening all over the world. We have women waking up everywhere. And it's they have a special connection between the women and a language that we all understand. And everywhere we go, Miriam and I, we travel. We've been to Spain. We've been to Zurich. I've been to Washington. We did it with the Palestinian women, with the Israeli women. We are here now in Germany. We are going to go to Brazil. Everywhere we go, and I'm telling you from experience, from through my eyes, my experience is that we have a common language that we all understand. We look into each other's eyes and we know. And it's not something that I can say it's a strategy. This is it's above strategy.
It's maybe a strategy, but for us, it's by spiritual things and not things that we are making like law or I'm a lawyer, but I find that spiritually is more powerful. And we are, as musicians, we are making this for a long time, but we give this the right expressions. And we try to spread this energy, this light, this spiritual words and music. And we get it back from people. We see how people change or how it influence. So this is our way now, and it's very powerful.
That's very powerful and impressive. The video testifies to that. But still, to play devil's advocate for a moment, if you want to convince a woman in Africa or in Latin America that it's better for her not to have a strong, dominant man,
I have to say something about that, because what ignited Prayer of the Mothers started in Africa, in Liberia. So it's, I don't have to convince the African women, they convinced me, okay?
Right.
Yeah. And also we don't have to convince anybody, we don't even want that. And how I see it, the time of change is already here, and it's only that mainly the women just coming together and living the change. The change is already here, and if you want to feel it, you can feel it everywhere. And convincing strategy for me, that it's like it's the old system, I'm not really interested in, and really more going well, you said intuition, but it's also like I ask myself sometimes, or I ask you, what do you think, where all your ideas come from? And suddenly it's like, oh, you have this great idea, like a light, and it shines on your path, and you exactly know what to do and to do it now. And this is how the Pulse of Peace or the Prayer of Mothers develop, and nobody can stop it, because it's a worldwide movement. And it's not a movement what was planned and to see how we can do it, how we can convince people. It's happening with all the people all over the world at the same time, because I think we receive something and we know it. Yeah, that's the truth. We are living our truth now. And the truth, one part of the truth of humanity is peace. And that's now, that's all.
Now, that may be true, and I hope you're quite right, but how do you convince the majority of the population? Take me as a simple example. I confessed to a terrible ignorance of the entire movement, Pulse for Peace, Peace March, or whatever. I didn't know about it. This is the first time I meet Yael Deckelbaum, the first time I meet you people. I think I'm fairly representative. Now let's take another question. We're here in the middle of Berlin. There are millions, not millions, but tens of thousands of refugees here, many of them coming from cultures where the role of women is not exactly, you know,